Good evening, people. We are starting the session now. I am Yashaswi, as you would have already probably read on the page. I am the CEO of Knappily. I am an alumnus of IIT Kharagpur and XLRI Jamshedpur. And I truly understand the anxiety that you must be going through. And given that there are just 3 more days to the exam, let us just start with the session. But before I start the session, let me just tell you what is the approach to the session. Okay. So the session is just hold on just 10 seconds. There is some technical issue here. Yeah. So the approach to the session is simple. I have gone through the questions which have been asked in the IIFT examination in the last 3 years, and I have tried to predict the questions that they can ask this year. Of course, how many would be asked is something we can't predict at the time, that we can only try our best. The point is that the paper is predictable in the sense that, you know, there are certain areas from which questions are asked, and the paper, the GK section is very factual. So either you know or you don't know, except for the match the following kind of questions, where even if you know one or two, you can match the entire, and the options are not close enough, right? So the approach is exactly that, to be able to predict similar questions that can be asked this year, right? So you have to bear with me. This session will be very factual, and at the end of the session you will get the slides. These slides you have to necessarily read after the session is over, because there will be a lot of facts mentioned there. The slides will be mailed to you, because we have your contact details anyway. So I'll just take you through the slides, and to begin with, I must also say there will be another session on Saturday. We'll let you know the exact time. There will be another session on Saturday so that we can predict more questions that would be asked in the examination. Right, so the first section here is sports. Inevitably, there will be 2-3 questions from sports this year, as they were asked in the last 3 years. Alright, so now this is a very complicated slide that you are seeing, but if you are interested in sports, you must already be familiar with at least a few of these points. Alright, so now Summer Olympics, right? The Olympics which we generally call are Summer Olympics, and we also have Winter Olympics. The important part is in 2024 they will be held in Paris, and 2028 they will be held in Los Angeles. This is the first time that two venues have been declared in one go. Right, so you can even find on Knappily, if you search for Paris Los Angeles Olympics, you will find an entire analysis for that. 2020 of course is Tokyo. Right, so Paris and Los Angeles, the two cities decided to collaborate with each other, and Los Angeles said they would agree to host it in 2028, provided they were given certain financial considerations. 2024 is Paris, so Olympics is returning to Paris after 100 years. The last time it was held in Paris was in 1924, and the last time, if I remember correctly, in Los Angeles it was in 1984. Yeah, 88 was here, so 1984 was Los Angeles Olympics. At the overall, now if I can go into this even for, let's say, a minute or two, the International Olympics Committee is finding it incredibly difficult to find hosts for their tournaments, because in what they have observed, what the cities have observed, is the hosts sooner or later become financially unviable. So that's why they decided to award two in one go, Paris and Los Angeles, the two cities which obviously will not collapse under the financial burden of hosting an Olympics. More importantly, Winter Olympics 2014 is done in Russia, Sochi Olympics. 2018 is Pyeongchang in South Korea. I think I just read an article yesterday, 72 days to go for this 2018 Olympics, and their biggest fear is that North Korea might launch a missile very close to South Korea when this is being held, right? So 2018 is Pyeongchang, 2022 is Beijing again. So that is for Olympics, Winter Olympics. Asian Games 2014 already done in Incheon, South Korea. India ranked 8th. It was a good 2022 is already controversial because Qatar is hosting it, and there are a lot of allegations that workers' human rights have been violated. That workers are being subjected to terrible working conditions there in Qatar. And 2022 Qatar, it will be held in the winter season, November, December, not during what is summer in India. Because of the climate requirements. FIFA Women's World Cup, the last time it was held in 2015 in Canada, USA won it. USA is the country which has won the Women's World Cup the maximum number of times. 2019, it will be held in France. FIFA president right now is Gianni Infantino, who has a tough job to clean up the entire system, which has been found to be corrupt. There were a lot of allegations that the 2018 and 2022 bid, which Russia and Qatar won, where bribery was involved in those bids. So he has to do a lot of cleanup. A committee has been set up. Gianni Infantino is FIFA president. IOC president is Thomas Bach. I think a few months ago he was appointed as IOC president. Commonwealth Games is what nobody cares about, except for the Queen and the host countries when it is held in countries other than those in the United Kingdom. So 2010 Delhi, we know Commonwealth Games was hosted in Delhi, and we know what happened subsequently. We can't go into that because that is not going to be asked in the question. So yeah, 2014 was Glasgow. 2018 is Gold Coast in Australia. 2022 was decided in favor of Durban, but then there was some controversy regarding the choice of the host city. The point is that Durban actually did not want to host it. South Africa did not want to host it. So again, the kingdom will have to do its job. So Commonwealth actually is a relic of the colonial past, and it will require probably half an hour to go into the history of Commonwealth and whether India made the right decision in joining the Commonwealth after becoming independent. Basically, the countries which were once part of the British Empire are part of, not necessarily, but most of them are part of the erstwhile British Empire. So these are your events which were recently held or which will be held in the coming year or years. Now this is one outcome which has been decided. So we know the countries which will be participating in the 2018 World Cup. The more important part is who will be representing Asia. So in the group AFC, the Asian countries would be Iran, Japan, Saudi Arabia and South Korea. They will be proceeding to the FIFA World Cup final, right? And Argentina has finally made it. If you follow football, Messi did his magic and they have made it. The Netherlands, interestingly, is out of the World Cup. A strong contender is out of the 2018 World Cup. So it was a huge setback. Other than that, see, I have told you before, once you get the slides, you'll have to look at the slides in a better manner than probably you are looking at right now. So that will do your job. But mostly if the question is asked on this, it will be either from Asia or Africa, the countries which are going to come. So we know about this FIFA U17, under 17. The first FIFA event in India, and the first time India participated in any FIFA major event, and that was also only because the host countries are allowed to participate in those tournaments. The captain of Indian team is Amarjeet Singh Kiam. That is one, again, a fact. There, the final was held in Kolkata, Salt Lake Stadium. England won the cup. It defeated Spain 5-2. Brazil came third while Mali was fourth in this under 17 tournament. Interestingly, England, the junior teams, both of them under 17 and under 20 are doing really well, and England has won both the events this year. Golden Ball was awarded to Phil Foden of England, and Fair Play Award was awarded to Brazil. So these are the facts from this. The last U17 was in Chile, and the next has not been decided yet, but it is speculated that it may be Nigeria, but still not officially decided. Now, under 17 Women's World Cup, Women's Cup is held separately. And here North Korea, to our great joy, has been ruling the charts. North Korea has won the Women's Under 17 World Cup the maximum times, which is two. It has not been held, I think it has been held 7 or 8 times, I'm not too sure, but North Korea has won it twice, including the recent one, which was in 2016, Jordan. The next Women's Under 17 Cup will be in Uruguay. So this is about Under 17, and I don't think any other question can be asked from this, since again, only facts can be asked. So India did not do well. India lost all their matches. There were a few bright spots, but India, I think, scored -8 points overall in their league. Now the next is Grand Slams. One question which is often asked in many quizzes at school level is, what is the order of the Grand Slams? Right, so it's Australian Open, French Open, Wimbledon, US Open. And if you see people like me who are comfortably above 30 will be happy to look at the winners of this year's Grand Slam. Federer and Nadal have shared all the four Grand Slams, split them actually between themselves. Federer won the Australian Open and the Wimbledon. Nadal, of course, won the French Open, and Nadal won the US Open. Nadal is currently rank 1. That was his target at the beginning of the year. The runners-up are also important, right? So that's when you pause the screen later, or you look at the slides and read, right? And when it comes to women, so women's is not as predictable as men's tennis. So we have four different winners for the four tournaments. Serena Williams, of course, Australian Open. She won when she was pregnant, so that was the best way to demonstrate how dominating she has been in tennis. Australian Open, Serena Williams. French Open, Yelena Ostapenko. Wimbledon, Garbine Muguruza. And US Open by the youngster Sloane Stephens, who defeated her friend Madison Keys. It was an emotional moment for the two friends. We know this because we have read this in Knappily. At least I know this. So, so what I'm saying is, if there has to be a question from sports, and there inevitably will be 2-3, they have to come from any of these areas. Now, ATP finals were conducted recently, so they may not be asked. Just for the facts, Grigor Dimitrov won the ATP finals, which comes just next to Grand Slam when it comes to overall points that are awarded to the winner. So Dimitrov defeated David Goffin. When it comes to ATP finals, the women's equivalent is WTA finals. And there, Caroline Wozniacki won the title. She defeated Venus Williams. Venus Williams, at the age of 37, managed to make it to the finals of the Wimbledon, the Australian Open, and the WTA. And she lost in all three. So she could not compensate for the absence of her sister there. I'm telling this story so that you can just remember. Otherwise, just to memorize from the facts is difficult to do. Right, so now the sport franchises, the leagues in India. IPL, this was the 10th edition. Of course, no straightforward question can be asked or should be asked. Interestingly, last year they asked two Bollywood questions. I'm not sure what was being judged through that. But that was, I think, an erratic event. Right, so Mumbai Indians won. They defeated Rising Pune Super Giant in the final. This was the third title of Mumbai Indians. Orange cap for maximum runs, David Warner. Purple cap for maximum wickets to Bhuvneshwar Kumar. Man of the series or the most valuable player was Ben Stokes. An emerging player was Basil Thampi. Basil Thampi, probably this can be the only question, I think. Other than that, cricket fanatics would be very sure of who won what. So emerging player is Basil Thampi of Gujarat Lions. Now, one pattern which I have observed is they ask who owned the team, who is the coach, captain, not necessarily, but usually who are the owners of teams of various leagues, of various franchises in various leagues of India. Right, so bear with the spelling mistake. It's not Gujarat Lions, it's Lions. I took it from somewhere, but it just distorts the meaning. So again, let us not go through this. I shouldn't be reading this. You can make better use of your time. Once you get it, you go through it. But usually celebrities associated with franchises are asked. And I doubt if they will ask it for IPL, because that's almost near universal knowledge in India. For the other leagues, of course, that can be asked. In any case, if you're not very familiar with IPL, the teams, the owners, then you have to spend some time on this slide. Right, so Indian Super League football has now come to India, FIFA 17, and before that, India Super League, which is of course now gaining in popularity. And now the owners are important. Who owns? Sachin Tendulkar has been at the forefront of owning various teams in various leagues. So Sachin Tendulkar is involved with Kerala Blasters along with the other actors so Chiranjeevi, Nagarjuna, Alu Arvind, they also own Kerala Blasters along with this Nimmagadda Prasad. And Prasad is actually an entrepreneur. So An Prasad and Sachin Tendulkar, they together have an entity, the name of which we will see. They together have an entity which takes which invests in various franchises. So Tendulkar is with Kerala Blasters. Right, again Ranbir Kapoor is with Mumbai City. John Abraham, I think the only real football fanatic, he is with Northeast United. His team is Northeast United. Hrithik Roshan is with Pune City. The only other time he has come to news is, of course, with in regards to Kangana Ranaut. Then I hope they won't ask that. So Tata Steel is Jamshedpur. They stay loyal to their city of the city where they work. Right. So these are the owners of the. So ISL is still on. The latest edition is still on. IMG, Reliance Industries, and Star Sports has been now. If you are reading Knappily, you would have read a latest nap on how Star Sports has changed its entire business model, Star India for that matter, from Saas Bahu serials to sports. That is the future, and it has been making good money on its investments in sports. So IMG, Reliance Industries, and Star Sports, they founded this Indian Super League, and now the winner of the three editions have been decided so far, three seasons. Two of them have been won by what is now ATK, Atletico de Kolkata, but after Atletico exited from this JV, they have called themselves ATK. So ATK won it in 2016 and in 2014. The 2015 season was won by Chennai, which defeated, this is the complete list of these franchises. So ATK is Saurav Ganguly, associated with, he's with ATK. And Abhishek Bachchan was, I think, meant for sports than for movies. Wherever he has invested in sports, his team has won. So Abhishek Bachchan is with Chennai, which won in 2015. MS Dhoni also is with Chennai. And the rest you can see. Virat Kohli is with Goa. Is the owner of, part owner of basically. These people actually, none of these sports persons own a majority stake in these franchises, but they are associated with it. Mostly they bring their brand and appeal and they get a part of the franchisee. Right, so ATK won last year and in 2014, the inaugural edition. Chennai won in 2015. Ganguly is with ATK. Sachin is with Kerala Blasters. Abhishek Bachchan with Chennai. Dhoni with Chennai. Virat Kohli with Goa. And the others probably you can read again when you see the slide. So this is with regards to the Super League for football. Now Hockey India League is, I wouldn't say it's doing really well when compared to other leagues, but started with a lot of promise. So it's sponsored by Coal India, Hockey India League. So it's actually called Coal India Hockey India League. And the winners of the last five seasons, you can see the latest ones are Kalinga Lancers, who defeated Dabang Mumbai and Punjab Warriors before that. The rest you can see, but it will mostly be Kalinga Lancers defeated Dabang Mumbai, if at all one question has to be asked on from this topic. Right, again, the owners of Hockey India League franchises, Dhoni is with Ranchi, of course. Ranchi Rays is owned by Dhoni and Sahara Adventure Sports. Sahara also owns Uttar Pradesh UP Wizards, JP Group Punjab Warriors, Do It Sports Management. They could have chosen a better name, but Do It Sports Management owns Dabang Mumbai, while Kalinga Lancer is a hardcore public sector ownership, Orissa Industrial Infrastructure Development Corporation and Mahanadi Coalfield Limited. They own Kalinga Lancers, which are the winners of the 2017 edition. Right? Hockey India, by the way, is the governing body for the sport in India. And of course, the big, let us say, success, the unexpected success is your Pro Kabaddi League. And when you go to your B school, I hope all of you do, you will go to a B school, you go to the B school of your choice. Pro Kabaddi League probably will come as a case study in marketing, branding, positioning, whatever you call it. One sport which was right down to the grassroots has been catapulted to the imagination of the country. And this, the credit goes to Charu Sharma. The entity he owns, his Mashal Sports, came up with this concept of Pro Kabaddi League in 2014. And then Star India invested in, I think they took a two-third stake in Mashal Sports. So now it is co-owned by both Mashal as well as Star India. So that is your Pro Kabaddi League. Now 2017 has four new teams in addition to the eight earlier. UP Yodha, Tamil Talaivas, Haryana Steelers and Gujarat Fortune Giants. I think Indian the franchises need to choose better names, but still. So you have UP Yodha, Tamil Talaivas, Haryana Steelers and Gujarat Fortune Giants as the four new teams. Nitin Tomar was in news because he was bought for a sum of 93 lakh by the UP Yodhas. It was an unbelievable sum to be paid for a Kabaddi player, but that has been the scale of success of PKL, that now probably in 1 or 2 years the prices of their players will rival those of IPL. Nitin Tomar is there. Now you have the winners here on the slide. Patna Pirates has won the last three seasons of PKL. The only difference is who did they defeat. They defeated Gujarat Fortune Giants, the newcomer. They went to the final. They were defeated by Patna Pirates this year. Before that, Jaipur Pink Panthers, which actually had won the inaugural edition and which is owned by Abhishek Bachchan. The first time he got into sports, he won. Jaipur Pink Panthers won. So as you see, the last three seasons have been won by Patna Pirates. There are four newcomers. Nitin Tomar was the one who got the highest auction price. Aside from that, I think you just need to know who owns these teams. Right, so the new teams, I think, are more important than the older ones. So Gujarat Fortune Giants by Adani Wilmar Limited. Haryana Steelers, JSW Sports. That explains why are they called Steelers. Tamil Thalaivas. Again, I was telling about the JV between Sachin Tendulkar and Ann Prasad. That JV is called iQuest Enterprises Private Limited. So in essence, Sachin and Ann Prasad own the Tamil Thalaivas team, the newcomer in PKL this year. Their company is called InQuest Enterprises, and UP Yodhas is owned by GMR Group. Aside from that, you have Kishore Biyani's feature group in Bengal Warriors, and you know these are he's the only other name which probably is no Ronnie Screwvala is U Mumba, right? And Abhishek Bachchan is Jaipur Pink Panthers. So these are the owners here. Now Premier Badminton League went through an unfortunate dispute because of which initially it was called as Indian Badminton League, started in 2013, and then there was a gap. And finally it came back in 2016, and now the 2017 session has been held this year. So the latest winners are Chennai Smashers, which won the 2017 session, and they beat Mumbai Rockets. The last season was won by Delhi Acers. 2013 is Hyderabad Hotshots, the inaugural edition. And like I said, there were certain legal complications and there were no other seasons there. More important is probably, see, if you are following sports or you are following Knappily, you do understand that the story of sports in India is that of badminton now. And we can safely predict that in 2020 Tokyo Olympics, Indian badminton team will bring at least 2 medals. Now the superstars are rising here. So most, if at all a question is asked, it will be who belongs to which team in Premier Badminton League. I think one question has already been asked with regards to this. That was 2 years ago. Right, so you find out your favorite names there. One more story which can be asked is, again, Tendulkar bought the Banga Beats, the Bangalore franchisee, and renamed it as Bengaluru Blasters. So Bengaluru Blasters is owned by Sachin Tendulkar now. Again, I'm sure it must be in association with An Prasad. So Tendulkar is investing. So it's like a business, not charity initiative. It's hardcore business, and it makes sense to get into these franchises right now. Right, so now the only question is who belongs to which team. So Saina Nehwal is Awadh, has been with Awadh. Sindhu is with Chennai Smashers, which won this year. And then you have Jwala Gatta. Now not many people care about her, but once upon a time she was a rising star. She is with Delhi Acers. We have Srikanth Kidambi, again a huge star who probably is now looking at a top ranking. Ashwini, so Srikanth and Nehwal are with Awadh Warriors. Ashwini Ponappa, again a partner of Jwala Gatta in doubles, once upon a time a leading medal contender from India in any international tournament, Bengaluru Blasters. And you have other, see, most of these are actually established players who are now doing really, really well. P. Kashyap is with Chennai Smashers now. So Samir Verma is doing really well. Ajay Jairam is doing really well. All these are there. So you have to just probably, if you're not very comfortable with badminton and badminton players, you will have to memorize. There's no other way out. You have to memorize their names and their teams here. Right, the Carolina Marin, the one who defeated PV Sindhu in 2016 Rio Olympics, she is with Hyderabad Hunters. That probably is also another thing that can be asked. Rio 2016, just for the sake of it, most of you must be knowing, these were the results. US, China, Great Britain. Great Britain did an outstanding job. That was the story of the time. And importantly, 2016, two new sports were introduced, golf and rugby sevens. And 2020, the new sports would be surfboarding, skateboarding, sport climbing and karate. Right? There will be new Olympic sports, and baseball or softball will be returning to the 2020. Still to be decided which one. Either of these will come to the 2020 return, not introduced, but return to the 2020 Tokyo Games. It's cricket, once upon a time, it went to Olympics. I think it was in the second Olympics in 1900, when cricket was also a part of the Olympics tournament. These are our winners from the last year. Again, shouldn't be asked, because this would be an easy question, a really easy question. Sindhu won the silver medal. Sakshi Malik bronze, and Deepa Karmakar came fourth but won hearts. India's overall rank was 67. So that was India at Rio. Right, so now, so I was just thinking how to take care of the questions where you have to match athletes with their sports. The what I have seen is most of these are Arjuna Award winners of that year. So I've just listed, I've just pasted the winners of the 2017 Arjuna Award, which is awarded to exemplary sports persons of India. And the best one, of course, gets the Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna. So these are the Arjuna Award winners of this year. You will have to, I shouldn't be reading out the names. You may not be familiar with let us say half of these names. So you have to do the reading, and you have to do the you don't have to memorize, you just have to remember, and you will be able to answer. Now Thangavelu is an interesting story. If you can answer this in your mind, of course, what is he known for? Right, so he won the gold medal in the Paralympics last year. A movie is being made on his life, and many documentaries. So he's the gold medalist, Paralympian from India. So he has also been given the Arjuna Award. He wasn't really happy with being given just the Arjuna Award because he thought Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna was within the reach. Now the problem here is there is some subjectivity involved in selecting these winners. They look into not just the performance in that year, but 4 years leading to this year. So basically 3 plus 1 year. And that leads to certain controversies and certain times. So it's not just that you win an Olympic medal and you will definitely be an Arjuna Award. Of course, Arjuna Award awardee you would be if you haven't been there because your points would be much higher. But to win the Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna, it has to be your good and consistent performance in the last 4 years. So this year's, this is the highest individual honor for a sports person in India, Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna. This year it has been awarded to Devendra Jhajharia, who is a Paralympian. He's a javelin thrower from India. And Sardara Singh, it was long due. He had been complaining for a long time, an ace player for Indian hockey for a long time now, and controversial too, but of course he deserved the award. It was a long time coming. Right, so these are the two winners from this year. The last year it was Sakshi Malik only. There were just 1 year in the last, one winners in the last 5 years. So before that, Jitu Rai, there were four winners the last year. Sindhu, Karmakar, Sakshi Malik, basically all, because it was an Olympic season, so they awarded to these three people. Jitu Rai lost out on his shooting medal. He was the strongest contender from India and he cried. He actually started weeping bitterly there. He lost out terribly on that. Still, it was, I think, a good tradition to start in India that they're not just only by their performance in the Olympics. So last year you had Sindhu Karmakar, Jitu Rai and Sakshi Malik winning the winners, winning the Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna. This year you have Jhajharia and Sardar Singh. That is about Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna. Right, so this is about sports. Of course, more questions can be generated and can be asked. But if you have to think from the mind point of view of the examiner, these are the things which probably you should know and therefore can be asked. Now, why do they ask about team owners? Because you are obviously applying for a business school. So you have to get interested in the business side of sports, probably. Not probably, surely. Yeah, so again, another factual, all of them are factual, but a hardcore factual topic is summits and places where the summits were held. So G7, the seven most advanced, most developed nations of the world, they meet every year. This summit is losing in relevance, primarily because you have G20, where anyway these G7 countries are present. So it makes little sense why should they show off by meeting again separately. But they do. So it's mostly a talk shop and they make certain statements here and there. And now 2017, this year it was held in Italy, and next year it will be held in Canada, right? The members are Canada, France, Germany, Italy, Japan, UK, and the United States. And European Union is represented. Of course, it's not a country, but it is represented in G7. So this is all you need to know about G7. This year it was in Italy, and next year it will be in Canada. G20, again on similar lines, supposedly the 20 biggest economies, not developed, but the 20 biggest economies of the world in terms of GDP, they are a part of this G20 grouping, and out of which 19 are countries and the 20th is the European Union. So technically speaking, there are 19 countries in the G20 grouping. The last one is European Union. 2017 was in Hamburg, Germany, the G20 meet. Next year it will be Buenos Aires, Argentina. 2019 Tokyo, Japan. 2020 Riyadh, Saudi Arabia. Right, so India was trying desperately, the government was trying desperately to get the 2018 slot, wanting to offer to Argentina that they may swap it later. But the point is, India doesn't have a slot to swap it with Argentina. The reason probably was only political. In 2018, India hosted a G20 summit, it would have been a very good political statement to show that Indian economy is doing really well. But that is not happening. And the fact is that and G20 summit has not been held in India ever. So India has yet to host a G20 summit, which is surprising, but again, it will happen. And it doesn't matter much beyond the optics. So G20 is also a what is usually called a talk shop. So people meet, they talk, they meet each other, and they make statements, mostly against terrorism and in favor of free trade and against Donald Trump, but not directly. So yeah, so BRICS is of course Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa. 2016, the last year, it was held in Goa, and this year it was held recently, I think month ago, in Xiamen, China. So this year's BRICS summit was in China. 2019, the next one will be in Johannesburg, South Africa. Sorry, I think this will be 2018, not 19, it's a typo here. This is 2018, it will be in South Africa. This is about BRICS. BRICS, of course, is a grouping which came together because Goldman Sachs mentioned BRIC in a report and people started talking about BRICS. And then South Africa joined in 2010 to make it BRICS. And many other countries want to join BRICS, but the point is that it will not be cool if any other alphabet is attached to BRICS. I think so. Maybe that's a joke actually. So yeah, ASEAN is the most important, many analysts say the most important trade group in the world is Association of Southeast Asian Nations. Also because European Union and the Eurozone, they have lost in relevance in the last 2-3 years. So the latest summit was held in the Philippines. If you follow news, or if you are a regular reader of Knappily, you would have read detailed coverage of the ASEAN summit. Again, a lot of statements were made, and interestingly, so President Duterte of the Philippines is a very fashionable person who can challenge Donald Trump anytime in making extreme statements. So they had a good time together, and statements were made, released. Not much was of substance, except for the fact that, and I've not put that here because the last year they asked the Trans-Pacific Partnership, TPP, about it. And Donald Trump withdrew from the TPP immediately after becoming president, and the remaining members, the other 11 members, met and they said, we will continue working for this Transatlantic Partnership without the United States. So that was one side meeting which happened in ASEAN. There are 10 member countries of ASEAN. India has been trying desperately to become a member of ASEAN, but it's not possible to do so. So India has a free trade agreement with ASEAN, and they meet regularly. Whenever ASEAN summit happens, India-ASEAN summit also happens. So this year is the Philippines. Next year, the next summit will be in Singapore. Now the members, these are the 10 members. Find a way to just recognize them. There are of course acronyms which can help you remember, but I think you'll just have to go through to those to answer questions such as, which of the following are not is not a member of ASEAN. Now there are other groupings associated with ASEAN. One is ASEAN plus 3. Now the 3 are China, Japan and South Korea. So they also meet whenever ASEAN meets. ASEAN plus 3 meeting also happens, and the most important, let's say, consequence of ASEAN is the East Asia Summit, which actually is ASEAN plus the 3, China, Japan and South Korea, and then you have 5 more countries, India, New Zealand, Australia, US and Russia. It used to be actually ASEAN plus 6. East Asia Summit used to be ASEAN plus 6. So India, Australia, New Zealand. In 2011, US and Russia also joined. So this is the group which is probably as important as, let's say, the European Union or any other big group. The point here is that US and Russia both are present, and not much happens. So ASEAN is a comfortable grouping where the countries cooperate with each other. It's a huge, huge success story when it comes to trade. And ASEAN is the biggest trading partner of India. Even if we include the groups, ASEAN is the biggest trading partner of India. UAE and ASEAN of course come close to each other. So UAE, ASEAN, you will find among the top two with regards to India's trading partner. Why is it UAE? And why would UAE be a top trading partner? Because most of the trade in the Middle East gets routed to India through Dubai, because it has a liberal system of trade. That's why you have UAE featuring there. Now, this summit is important. Trade grouping is important. It's proposed right now, not yet frozen. RCEP, Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. It has become more important since Donald Trump withdrew from the TPP, because TPP primarily was supposed to counter China. And RCEP is going to be a China-led group, of which India also will be a part. Right, so basically it's proposed that these countries with which ASEAN has existing free trade agreements, which as I told earlier, that ASEAN plus 6, they all should become a part of a formal trading group, which means sort of like your Eurozone. Not Eurozone, not the same currency, but the larger European Union. Right, so this has come to prominence after TPP lost United States as a possible member. So RCEP is ASEAN plus 6, so you have to know the members here. Right, so now SAARC is probably the only relevance of SAARC is because questions are asked about it in competitive exams. Other than that, the biggest country of SAARC, which is India, has totally abandoned it, primarily because it doesn't want to deal with Pakistan in this group. In 2016, the summit was supposed to be held in Islamabad. India asked the fellow SAARC members to boycott the summit, and to the surprise of everybody, including even that of India, all other members decided to not attend the summit in Islamabad, which probably was not very good diplomatically, but then India showed its regional weight through SAARC. 2018, tentatively, it has to be in Bengaluru. But most likely India will not be keen on conducting this summit, because India doesn't want to talk to Pakistan, and here it will have to talk to Pakistan. So this is about SAARC, South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation. This is a huge failure. There's nothing which has come out of SAARC. It inevitably would become India versus Pakistan, and all the news would be about India and Pakistan, Indian and Pakistani Prime Minister meeting on the sidelines of SAARC summit. Aside from that, there is nothing of significance. So the members of SAARC, the 8 members are Afghanistan, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal, the Maldives, Pakistan and Sri Lanka. Afghanistan was the last member to join, I think, in 2007 or 2008. Right, so this is about SAARC. Now APEC was in news along with ASEAN, because Donald Trump made his Asia visit, and he was also present in the APEC summit around that time. In 2017, this year, it was held in Da Nam, which is a city in Vietnam. So Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation, these are all Pacific Rim countries, 21 of them, I think, 21 countries of the Pacific Rim, which come together and discuss its various areas of cooperation. It's not a free trade zone. So less related to trade and more related to symbolism. Now, non-aligned movement is... the movement got so non-aligned that even its members are now not aligned with NAM. That is the current state of NAM. So again, only to be asked in quiz questions or GK sections in various competitive exams. The last summit of NAM was held in Venezuela, in the city called Porlamar. And Narendra Modi did not participate in this summit, which actually was criticized because India is a co-founder of the non-aligned movement. And so India was represented by the Vice President Hamid Ansari at that time. Not many countries actually visited Venezuela, because Venezuela is a country again which is subjected to a lot of criticism for human rights violation, and a lot of other issues are there. So 2019 it will be in Azerbaijan, Jakarta. Again, a movement whose time is up. We can talk a lot about non-aligned movement, but again, you don't have to answer in an interview question. So let's leave it. And BIMSTEC is the regional forum of choice for India. It was easy to remember the members of BIMSTEC, because the initials actually come from those. Bangladesh, India, Myanmar, Sri Lanka. Right? So it used to be Bangladesh, India, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, and then other countries also joined. So the name actually changed to Bay of Bengal Initiative for Multisectoral Technical and Economic Cooperation. That's the full form of BIMSTEC. Not relevant, of course. The members are Bangladesh, India. So B, Bangladesh, India, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, right? And yeah, till Thailand. Sri Lanka, you can go till Thailand. Thailand. So that's BIMST. Now Bhutan and Nepal joined subsequently. So these are the members of BIMSTEC. India prefers to deal with this group because it has all its regional allies here, and the one enemy it does not want, the two which it does not want, which are China and Pakistan. So India is happy to promote this. In 2016, when BRICS summit was held in Goa, India arranged for the BIMSTEC summit on the sidelines of the BRICS to show the importance of this summit. 2017, it will be again held in Nepal. 2015, it was held in Nepal, the BIMSTEC summit. Now, OPEC's annual flagship meeting is called the International Seminar of the Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries. I think one of the most frequently asked questions in most GK sections of most competitive exams is, where is the headquarters of OPEC? Because it doesn't make sense why Vienna in Austria should be chosen as the headquarter for a grouping which has most of whose members are Middle East countries and which is dominated by Saudi Arabia. The point was, they wanted a venue which was agreeable, you know, to all, and which was deemed to be fair, not a lot of controversy around it. So they decided Vienna will be where they would have their headquarters. Right. So of course the seminar is held in Vienna every year. The members are Algeria, Angola, Ecuador. You can read it from the slide anyway. Indonesia is a former member, so they have certain rules to be a member. Indonesia became a net importer of oil. A net importer of oil cannot be a part of OPEC. And also the members have to pay a lot of fees to be a part of this group. Again, now if you were appearing for an interview, OPEC would be a very interesting topic, primarily because of the price of oil, crude oil right now. In your mind, just answer the question, what is the crude oil price right now? How much, how many dollars per barrel? Good if you can answer it. But if you see, so I'll just take 2-3 minutes. India is the biggest one of the biggest beneficiaries of low oil prices prevailing in the world right now. Why? Because India is a huge net importer of crude oil. 75% of the oil requirements of India are met by imports. That simply means that it adds to a lot of, it puts a lot of pressure on India's trade deficit, or what you call current account deficit. So current account deficit is simply trade deficit plus other, dollar obligations. So trade deficit increases when oil prices go high. Narendra Modi was one of the luckiest prime ministers in India in recent times, primarily because when he came to power, oil prices were falling and kept on falling. It came down to around $30. And now it seems like the prices are rising towards 60, may touch 70. The group which decides what to do with the price is OPEC, right? And now the point is, why is OPEC not? So OPEC controls supplies. They will agree to production cuts. Let's say if they have to increase the price, they would just agree that, you know, we will cut down the supplies by 5%. The member countries will cut down the supplies by 5%. The reason they are not doing so is because they are going through an existential crisis. If the crude oil price, let's say, crosses $65, shale oil will again come back to contention. Shale oil is the biggest producer of shale oil, SHALE. Say shale oil is the United States. It has become self-sufficient in oil requirements, the United States, primarily because of shale oil. The technology that is used in extracting shale oil is called fracking, F-R-A-C-K-I-N-G. That simply means horizontally splitting the rocks to extract shale, which is distributed horizontally, unlike, crude oil, where you dig vertically and suddenly you hit oil and you can extract the oil. This requires horizontal cracking of the of rocks, right? So if it goes beyond 65, these shale oil companies which are close to bankruptcy, they will start doing good business, and again the price will fall. So it's a hugely interesting topic, the price of shale oil. I think if I remember in, correctly, in IIFT, after you get a call, they the last year they asked which is one event, which is one global event that you think will determine geopolitical event that will be a very important phenomenon in the coming year, something like that. The obvious choices, of course, were Brexit, Donald Trump. My favorite was crude oil price, that the lowest has been achieved. Now it will only grow from here. Anyway, that is about OPEC and oil. My services actually for you can be better used when it comes to discussing various topics. But since this is our first interaction, let us do justice to the topic, to the purpose at hand, which is IIFT questions. Right, so yeah. So again, certain facts here and there taken randomly based on pattern. Don't ask me why is Earth our here. It's here because I somehow think if not in this year, then the next year they would ask that who organizes the Earth hour, which is the practice of switching off all the lights, electric equipment for 1 hour from 8:30 to 9:30 p.m. On any day towards the end of March. This year it was on the 25th of March. In 2017, it was on the 25th of March. It is organized by WWF, which is the Worldwide Fund for Nature. Started in Sydney, Australia in 2007, and it has become a global practice, a huge social media phenomenon. Although critics say not much is achieved, this is merely symbolism, because the problem is people immediately compensate for that power that they don't use for that 1 hour. Now, the topic which Donald Trump thinks is fake news is climate change. Again, a huge topic for discussion group, you know, whether it's a group discussion or a one-on-one or an interview or anything. But to keep it factual, the summits are officially called United Nations Climate Change Conferences. The UN summits are called UNCCC, Climate Change Conferences. Now, it comes under the purview of UNFCCC, which is United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. Hey, so here, what is called the Conference of Parties, COP, right? The formal meeting is called the Conference of Parties. So the COP is conducted in these climate change conferences, and currently their task is to negotiate a substitute to the Kyoto Protocol, which actually has been achieved. The only question is how to actually phase out the Kyoto Protocol and move completely to the Paris Agreement. Right, so this has been occupying the attention of the conference of the parties. 2015 Paris is, I think if you don't know that 2015 Paris, there was an agreement on climate change. To use Donald Trump's phrase, it is really, really bad. And you're not using Knappily, which makes it worse. So again, 2015 was in Paris. And these people will always have Paris. They will continue talking about Paris for the next 5 years. Not much will be achieved, but they will talk about the Paris Agreement. 2016 was in Morocco, in Marrakesh. 2017, it will be held in Bonn, Germany, where again, they expect to push this forward. 2018 will be in Poland, in the city called Katowice. 2018 will be there. So yeah, France, Paris, Morocco, Marrakesh, and this year is Bonn, Germany. Sustainable Development Goals, again, this topic has been neutralized. The last year they asked, it was a simple question. The question I think was, SDGs replaced which of these targets? The answer of course was the Millennium Development Goals, because the MDGs were supposed to last between 2000 and 2015, and the results were mixed, not much was achieved. However, they wanted to have a more ambitious replacement. So they got this time, the MDGs had 8 goals. So SDGs have 17 goals. And the target is again, so 2030. From 2016 to 2000, another 15 years have been dedicated towards achievement of these goals. 17 goals, they have 169 targets among them. What you see on the screen is an overall theme of these goals, but these are all hardcore quantified targets. Each goals will yield certain targets, and each country has to commit to meeting these targets. A huge discussion can be on where is India positioned right now when it comes to meeting these targets. Where shall we be struggling, and where will we be struggling, and where we will be able to manage it well, right? Since I said Paris Agreement, so the Paris Agreement basically is something which anyway they keep talking about, just that they agreed to it in written in 2015, that they want to keep the global warming to well below, that's what the agreement says, well below 2 degrees Celsius, which simply means that they want to strive for 1.5 degrees Celsius over pre-industrial revolution levels. Right, so the overall average temperature should not increase by more than not by more than 2 degrees, but ideally by up to not more than 1.5 degrees Celsius before the industrial revolution began, which tentatively, which usually is 1750. Right, so again, a topic of debate, climate change, whether it's happening, whether it's man-made, whether it's inevitable that it will happen. If you look at it, in the last 100 years, there are various surveys and various statistics. Usually it is said that the climate, the average climate temperature has increased by 0.3 to 0.5 degrees Celsius. Right, but the point is 0.5, if the 2 degrees Celsius is extremely important, because at that level, many crops will not be able to survive, which will lead to a huge changes in the global ecosystem. That is why you find this 2 degrees Celsius mentioned everywhere. Right, so now they say, like it is the case with all these global targets, these are non-binding goals. Basically, the countries have voluntarily committed to meeting these goals, but they're all non-voluntary, which means that they will try their best, but nobody can send them to jail if they don't do this. Like Donald Trump has said, he won't do it. Nothing is going to happen as a result of that. So he has withdrawn the United States from this Paris 2015 agreement, because he thinks climate change is a hoax. This is made up by countries such as China and India to extract concessions from the powerful countries like the United States, and a lot of other things. Again, Donald Trump, I can talk for 10 hours continuously. One of the most fascinating characters ever, along with Kim Jong-un. Okay, no jokes. So there are no, binding deadlines. So again, what I'm saying is, these will be extremely important for your interview, for your group discussion, anywhere you go. Right now, we will just focus on the facts which come from here. Of course, Narendra Modi has enthusiastically adopted ambitious targets. Most of them actually factor in that India will move towards solar power. And those calculations are very, very optimistic. Of course, a lot of progress has happened, but the extent to which it has been projected, most experts say that cannot happen. In any case, it's good to have an ambitious target to at least get half the way there. Right, so now one mechanism here is that every 5 years, beginning the next year, every 5 years, countries will take stock of the overall impact, and they will submit a report. No action will be taken, of course, if they don't meet it. But every 5 years, they will be reporting what they have achieved to the entire, all the countries of the United Nations. Financing is a huge issue there. So rich countries have to, there's something called the polluter pays principle, that since the countries which benefited from the industrial revolution, the developed countries, they were the ones who pumped in the maximum carbon in the atmosphere historically in the last 250 years, they should be paying for correcting these adverse impacts, and therefore they should be funding those countries which are just now starting, countries such as India which is yet to be industrialized. Why should India now commit to not industrializing when other countries have already done it? So the agreement is that the rich countries will fund the environmental friendly technology to be used by the developing countries, and that's how the world will tackle the problem of climate change. Now, $100 billion is one figure which keeps coming everywhere, that the commitment that the developed countries have made is that of the $100 billion, but it's not sacrosanct and it surely will not be met, because as soon as there is some financial constraint, most countries do not fulfill their commitment. This has been observed in most of these outcomes of these such agreements. So that is one problem with this agreement. Of the many problems, why do we celebrate Paris? Almost every country in the United Nations agreed that climate change is happening and something has to be done about it, and they undertook voluntarily to do something about it, and finally we have a replacement for the Kyoto Protocol, and it will happen gradually. In 2020 is when this will come into effect. So finally we have, actually these people have a place to meet. They will now meet for reviewing Paris Agreement. Right, so that's about the summits. Now this is, I just kept it because you have such questions asked, but I am surely not going to read out these brands. Unilever, Procter & Gamble, Colgate, ITC, which match the following, which brand belongs to which of these companies. So you just go through these when you get the slides, or you pause, you'll of course get the recording too. You pause the recording and have a look at these brands. So why is it here? It's just here because the pattern compels us to look into these, right? And actually speaking, this is a very, very difficult to answer, which brand belongs to P&G and which brand belongs to Unilever. And by the way, when you go for your B school and you want your internship and you are passionate about marketing, you will be dying to get into either Unilever or P&G. These are the most sought after job, and then you have your Desi Group, ITC, which will be your third choice. So these are the brands of ITC. These are the brands of Godrej also is here. You might be smiling, but I don't know who uses Godrej number one soap, but still it's here. I hope they won't ask this. So let's go to the next one. Let's see, like I have told you before, I will take another session. This is not getting over, so don't exit. On Saturday, I think tentatively let's put it at 3 p.m. on Saturday. I'll take another session so that I can put in more facts. And because if you attend it on Saturday, you will surely go and you don't even need to look at the slides. You will go and answer it the next day. Right, so Zika virus it did a lot of damage, mostly in Brazil, but it was a nightmare. Because it visited Brazil around just before the Olympics, the Rio Olympics. Certain facts about the Zika virus: it comes from the family Flaviviridae. More importantly, it is carried by the Aedes mosquitoes, A. aegypti and A. albopictus. These are the two variants of the Aedes mosquito. The name comes from the Zika forest of Uganda, where the virus was first isolated. Now, it is closely related to the dengue, yellow fever, encephalitis, and a disease called West Nile virus. It's difficult to know if the person affected is showing the symptoms of this or the other disease. As in 2015, like I said, in Brazil, it caused havoc. And now, the interesting case was about microcephaly. So what was observed was that many children were being born with abnormally large swollen heads, brains. And it was observed that their mothers, many of those, not all, but many of those, the mothers, they had contracted Zika when they were pregnant. So it was believed that Zika can result in microcephaly, which is a swelling of head in children, a terrible disease. But of late, in the last 1 year, a lot of research has refuted this, that just because they are present does not mean that Zika actually causes this. The other conditions also are responsible for this microcephaly. Right, so this is one. And these are again miscellaneous topics. Human Development Index, India's rank is 131 on HDI. The important part to understand is when we say human development, this index, which was developed by UNDP, United Nations Development Program. I've not mentioned in the slide, I'll probably put it later. UN Development Program in 1990. It was Amartya Sen and a Pakistani economist, I think called Mehboob Haq. They developed these metrics to understand what is the status of human development in various countries, understand and compare. So it has three pillars: health, education, and living standards. Health is measured by life expectancy at birth. Right, so each country has their life expectancy at birth. That has a weightage. These three have one-third weightage overall. So life expectancy at birth represents health. Education has two metrics. One is the expected years of schooling, which means a child born today should ideally expect how many years of schooling. And the other is mean years of schooling, which means an adult living in the country has had how many average years of schooling. So these two go into education. And living standards is measured by the per capita GDP, gross national income per capita. Put together, they lead to your human development index, and then the countries are ranked as per this. Right, so India's rank was 131 in this. This is a terrible slide, I must admit, but the point is, if they ask such questions, then you have to bear such slides. So you have these organizations and their headquarters. If obviously you would know that if you have to randomly mark an answer about where is the headquarter of a particular international organization, you would go for Geneva most likely. Right, I'll show you that to you in the next slide. But these are your organizations and headquarters. You will have to be sure of who is located where. Right, other than that, I don't see any. So Amnesty International is London. India has been, the government has been totally against Amnesty International. They're having a tough time in India. I'm not going to predict which one will come. This is hardly. FAO is Rome. I think match the following can come from this. International Court of Justice is The Hague, the Netherlands. ASEAN headquarters is in Jakarta, in Indonesia. UNICEF is USA. Paris, UNESCO is Paris. These are important ones. So you have to go through these. OIC is Organization of Islamic Cooperation, not to be confused with OPEC. This is a political organization, and OPEC is a business or business setup. It's in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia, OIC. And the others you have to just read and memorize. Right, ICANN is International Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, the ones which control all the domain names. I used to control, now they have liberalized the system. They are headquartered in Los Angeles. And this is your ready list of all the organizations which are headquartered in Switzerland, mostly Geneva. Right, so World Economic Forum, World Trade Organization, World Meteorological Organization, World Health Organization, ILO, UNCTAD, all these are in Geneva. In your mind, just answer the question, why would so many organizations be headquartered in Geneva? And you know what is happening in the European Union. Okay, I'm live. We got stuck somewhere. I don't know where did we get stuck. Right, so I'm not sure where did we miss out from. But what I was saying is, I'm repeating, if you have heard it already, then I don't know, relax for some time. Most of these headquarters are in Geneva, Switzerland. I'd ask the question, why would why would so many headquarters be located in Switzerland? And I answered that question myself, because of course I can't hear your answers right now. It's not a two-way communication and I'm not reading the comments. So the point is, Switzerland has had a history of being neutral. It was not a party to the two world wars. And that is why when you locate your the headquarters of a truly international organization, you will want it to be in a country which will not swing one way or the other when it comes to huge geopolitical events. That's why Switzerland. And maybe it's a beautiful country, so they agreed immediately on that. Right, so European Union is where we have come to. European Union, so you see the road on the slide. I hope you can see the slide. The road on the slide, the end of the road has led to, say that in your mind, of course, Brexit. So now, of course, probably I will be taking a detailed session, a 3-hour session on all that is wrong with the European Union and how can it be set right. Right now for us, again, to speak of facts, it actually, European Union is, when you say it was founded, it came to be known as the European Union in 1992 after the Maastricht Treaty. In 1992, after the Maastricht Treaty, it came to be known as the European Union, but it had been evolving all through. Just that the name came and there was some formalization. They got themselves a parliament, a headquarter, and the origins of the European Union lie in World War II again. Because Germany and France had managed to destroy each other completely on the opposite sides. Europe was was at 70% devastated when it came to property and people. And the only way to build it again was for the two countries, the two bitter enemies, Germany and France, to cooperate. At that time, West Germany, of course, because Germany got divided in two parts after the World War. And surprisingly, it was survival that brought the enemies together. Of course, it was a Western government, an allied government installed in West Germany. So that started the story for the European Union. Six of them came together. I think I remember Luxembourg, Belgium, Germany, France, two others. And the two most important treaties for the EU are European Economic Community, the Treaty of Rome, that is the 1957 Treaty of Rome. If you are a hardcore follower of news, which means if you are a regular follower of Knappily, you would probably have come across European Union celebrating their 60th year of existence. That came from the Treaty of Rome. So they recognized the Treaty of Rome as they're coming into existence, and people of course were laughing at it because they are now trying to kill each other. In the last two, three, they have spent the last 2 years doing exactly that. The other important facts are, of course, the launch of Euro. So currently there are 28 members of the European Union. 28 countries are part of the European Union, including the United Kingdom. And when the UK exits, it will be 27. So there's a term called EU27 now, which you frequently hear about. That EU27 is actually EU minus UK. That is the future of EU. And I'm just trying to think what question can possibly be asked. Of course, this is a huge topic of discussion. What is the impact on India, on Europe, on the rest of the world, whether the European experiment has failed? All those are topics for huge discussions. But factually, I don't know. This could be the only one, that Article 50 of the Lisbon Treaty. As you would have read, Article 50 has been triggered, which means that by the end of March 2019, Britain would exit the European Union. It has been triggered. So this Article 50 is that of the Lisbon Treaty. So when we hear terms such as divorce. Divorce between the European Union and Britain, it is talking about Article 50, which has various provisions there. The newest member to join EU is Croatia. So that is the 20th member of the European Union. What we call Eurozone is actually a smaller grouping. not all the countries of European Union use euro as their currency. In fact, the UK also does not use euro as the currency. The anger actually on the United Kingdom right now, which of course the rest of the EU is making very clear to them, is that UK had always got a preferential treatment. They always had got exemptions. They joined, I think, in 1973 after a lot of drama, and they are exiting with a lot of drama. This is an unnecessary development, but this is the age of referendums. In 2016, the referendum happened in June, I think 23rd of June, where surprisingly people voted to exit. The British people voted to exit the European Union. And that process will take at least 2 years to complete, and a lot of complications will occupy the United Kingdom for many more years. Two rankings, I think India's rank in SDI, Human Development Index, I said before, 131, ease of doing business. I came, I think, 3 weeks ago, so not sure if this will be asked, but still it is 100. It has jumped 30 places from 130. So I think the headline was India is in top 100 now. Nobody said that India actually is 100th. But yeah, technically India is in top 100 now. Again, so should we be happy about this, sad about this? A huge story. You can read this in Knappily. Actually, if you just search for these keywords, of course for IIFT you don't have so much time, but if you search for the keywords, you'll be able to find those naps, and you can read them later. A lot of controversy around why should a country's focus be on improving the ranks in ease of doing business. But the fact is that, you know, more investment will come if India continues to improve the rank in the ranking. Now, fortune list, again, a favorite topic for asking questions. So the Indian companies which are right now in the fortune list, there are 7 Indian companies in the latest one in 2017. They are Indian Oil is the highest ranked at 161. The other public sector companies are SBI, and then you have Bharat Petroleum, you have Hindustan Petroleum, you of course have Reliance Industries, Tata Motors, and a new entrant is Rajesh Exports. So everybody got to know about Rajesh Exports when the news said that it is in the Fortune 500 list there. Right, so the order is IOC, Reliance Industries, Tata Motors, SBI, Bharat Petroleum, Hindustan Petroleum, and then you have Rajesh Exports at 423. So this is the fortune list. Again, so Dada Saheb Phalke Award this year went to K. Vishwanath. That is the only thing I think that can be asked. The last 3 winners were Manoj Kumar, Shashi Kapoor, Gulzar, and the last three winners. Dada Saheb Phalke Award is the highest award given by the Government of India for movies, and this is a lifetime achievement award. Quickly, again, many questions have already been asked from this. The Bretton Woods system and the World Bank group. So what is the Bretton Woods system? When the world was half destroyed, which means Europe was destroyed in the Second World War, there was a clear need to have an international financial mechanism that can take care of the funding needs of these countries. For that, extensive discussions were held through 1944 and 45. They are called the Bretton Woods system because the location was Bretton Woods in the United States. And the two most important outcome was IMF and IBRD, the International Bank for Reconstruction and Development, which came to be known as the World Bank and which is now also a part of the World Bank Group. So don't confuse the World Bank with the World Bank Group. When we say the World Bank, we actually mean IBRD. And then you have your International Monetary Fund. They have very specific mandates to do. So basically IMF the task is to ensure the stability of currency. IBRD is, as the name itself suggests, for reconstruction and development to give low interest loans, but frequently we find their mandates overlapping. Of course, a lot of controversy around that fact that they mostly serve the business interests of American companies. And so these are your Bretton Woods. So IMF and IBRD are they emerged from the Bretton Woods. The World Bank Group has 5 branches now, one of which is World Bank or IBRD. Then you have International Development Association, IDA. You have International Finance Corporation, IFC. You have Multilateral Investment Guarantee Agency, MIGA. And then you have International Center for Settlement of Investment Disputes. There is no cool acronym for this, abbreviation for this. But you should remember that these 5 are the parts of the World Bank Group. The biggest part, of course, is the World Bank. Each of them have their specific mandates. Right, so MIGA, for example, is used to settle disputes arising between 2 countries when one country invests in the reconstruction or projects of another country. So this is your Bretton Woods system. Again, another important development in the last few years is New Development Bank, which was started by the BRICS countries and which is being positioned as an alternative to the World Bank and the IMF, to the Bretton Woods system, which is accused of serving the interests of the developed countries. So this bank will focus on the needs of the developing countries, not necessarily only the BRICS countries. For the developing countries, the headquarters is in Shanghai, and here the problem with the IMF and the World Bank is primarily their voting structure. They are not, for example, India's frequent demand is that it is one of the biggest economies when it comes to GDP, but its voting power do not reflect its economic stature. They are very resistant to reforms. New Development Bank showed the way. Now all these 5 BRICS states, they have an equal number of shares and equal voting rights, and no country has veto power here. It is headquartered in Shanghai, China, and the president is K.V. Kamath, who was earlier associated with. He actually is the one who built ICICI Bank to the brand that it is now. Another emerging financial behemoth is Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank, AIIB. It is of course being promoted by China. 53 countries have already signed the articles of agreement. The current president is Jin Liquan. This is AIIB, again China led initiative. I've not put the Belt and Road Initiative, China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, and other such frequently occurring, which means the topics which you anyway can't avoid. Even if you just don't want to read news, you would read about them inevitably. But probably it's a good idea I put them in the next session so that at least I can claim that it was there in the PPT. It was a joke. Nobel Prizes 2017. If at all they would ask who won the Nobel Prize this year for a certain field, it would probably be for literature or peace or economics. So as you would know already, the economics prize is called Nobel Memorial Prize. It's not the actual real Nobel Prize, because Alfred Nobel did not put economics, there was no such field to speak frankly at that time. So he had not put economics in his will. So the hardcore Nobels are physics, chemistry, medicine, literature, and peace. So this year's Nobel Peace Prize went to a relatively new group. I think they're just 10 year old. International Campaign to Abolish Nuclear Weapons, ICAN. The Literature Award went to Kazuo Ishiguro, which of course was well deserved. I'm not going to read out the names of these 3 people in physics, chemistry, and medicine, 3 each in each of them. But of course you just have a look at their names. if they are really sadist, they would ask who among the following is not a winner of the Nobel Prize in Physics. But I don't think they are that. Right, so economics went to Richard H. Thaler for a very interesting theory that many critics say is actually not economics at all, which is called behavioral economics, which means there's a lot of psychology to how people invest and how people about books and author. So these are the books from Ishiguro himself, who has won the Nobel Prize in literature. Since these are all translated, I hope they don't ask Japanese names, but these are the ones. Sorry. Just hold. Just hold on, I'm just connecting again. So Man Booker Prize was earlier given to any book in English published in the Commonwealth and necessarily published in the United Kingdom too. That was the case earlier, but in 2013, any English language publication anywhere in the world became eligible for this Man Booker Prize, which simply meant that the Americans could now participate, and they actually even started winning the award. The 2014 winner was Richard Flanagan for The Narrow Road to the Deep North, 2015 Marlon James for A Brief History of Seven Killings, 2016 Paul Beattie for The Sellout. This was for 2016. And 2017 is George Saunders for Lincoln in the Bardo. A very interesting story premise, a different kind of storytelling. The setting is a graveyard, and the conversation is between one dead person and the other ghosts in the graveyard. It has been covered in Knappily. So by the way, you can get all these Nobel Prize the analysis as a separate magazine for Knappily. If you go to the website, you can get them there. Now the Indian winners so far of the Man Booker Prize are Arundhati Roy. Arundhati Roy for The God of Small Things, Kiran Desai for The Inheritance of Loss, and Aravind Adiga for The White Tiger. Salman Rushdie does not consider himself Indian, but we consider him as our own because he has won awards. So, so Midnight's Children by Salman Rushdie is another one. But surely three Indians, Kiran Desai, Arundhati Roy, and Aravind Adiga, have won the Man Booker Prize. There, Arundhati Roy was also shortlisted this year, and I'm forgetting the name of the book, but that is also important. I just put it in the PPT after the session is done. small points. Chief Justices of India, the recent one is Deepak Misra. Before this JS Kher, I think they should change the way they elect the Chief Justice of India. It's always the senior most justice in the Supreme Court, regardless of how much tenure is remaining. So in many cases you find, so for example, you see T.S. Thakur, he retired on 3rd January 2017. The next one, J.S. Kher, retired in August 2017. Just simply because J.S. Kher was a senior most justice at that time, and regardless of the fact that he would have retired in 6 months, he became the Chief Justice. Currently it is Deepak Misra who will be the Chief Justice till 2nd October 2018. So for the next IIFT, which I hope none of you have to write, you will have a different Chief Justice of India. I think we are coming towards the end of the just 2-3 more slides. Now certain facts from the Census of India, I just put them here because you should know first, and maybe they will ask, hopefully. Census 2011 was the 15th Census of India. Officially the population, because the official population figures are come every decade when the census is done, is 121 crores, and the most populated states are UP, Maharashtra, Bihar, West Bengal, AP, Madhya Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh. This is the order of the most populated states of India. right? So UP, Maharashtra, Bihar are the top three most populated states of India. The overall sex ratio of India, the good news was that it had increased to 914 in census 2011. Sex ratio of 940 simply means there are 940 females for every 1000 males in India. Right, so while this was, and Kerala of course has the highest sex ratio, which is 1084 as per census 2011, which means there are 1084 females for every 1000 males in Kerala. And of course there's a proper explanation to all these trends, but we cannot get into that right now. And Pondicherry or Puducherry comes next at 1038. Daman and Diu, the union territory of Daman and Diu, has the lowest sex ratio of 618 females per 1000 males. The disappointing part, the most distressing part of the census 2011 results were that the child sex ratio declined in India to 914. Child sex ratio is 914. Child sex ratio means females by males in 0 to 6 years. This simply means that in the coming years, this gain in overall sex ratio will be neutralized and reversed. And the fact that in 0 to 6 years it is 914 points that in India, in female feticide is more common than what is acknowledged. Because otherwise there is no way that naturally the ratio just cannot be this low. An increasing trend in this ratio, which means the ratio became worse in Punjab, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, Gujarat, right? An increasing trend, which means that they improved there in Punjab, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, Gujarat, Tamil Nadu, Mizoram and Andaman and Nicobar, and it declined in all other states of India. In any case, overall 914 is shameful, probably the best statistic to show that this is not a country that values its women. Now, literacy rate has gone up in India. Officially it is 74% now. I was reading a news report to this earlier, some survey done, that this overall literacy rate has improved to 80% there. In any case, again, this is functional literacy, by the way. So how India defines literacy rate, if you can just sign on a piece of paper, you are literate, and you can read your signature, you are literate. So this has got nothing to do with education, right? So it's that kind of literacy. So only for symbolism is this important. Percentage growth in literacy rate, again, the heartening fact was that the growth was higher among the females than it was among the males, which means the gap between the two will sooner or later be bridged. That is one. These are of course from the census. The density of population in India is 382 people per square kilometer, and that is one. The others are already covered in the previous slide. Yeah, women CEOs, they ask, match the women CEOs with their companies, or straight away who among the following is the CEO of this company. So these are the women leaders of the Fortune, of the top Fortune companies basically right now. Mary Barra is in General Motors. Meg Whitman recently resigned as the CEO of HP, but she will continue to be the CEO of HP till the end of February. So officially your answer will remain Meg Whitman for HP. Virginia Romney is for IBM. Indra Nui, every child knows, is PepsiCo. Incidentally, whenever you ask somebody in an interview, let's say if I have to do a mock interview, I ask you who is your favorite women leader, you will say Indra Nui. And then you will not know anything beyond that, but you would say Indra Nui because you know about her. And she visits India a lot. Right, so anyway, so Marilyn Hewson is for Lockheed Martin. Safra Kaz is for Oracle. Erin Rosenfield is for Mondelez International. And Ursula Burns is for Xerox Corporation. Why are these companies here? They are the top 20 Fortune 500 companies. So these women are leading these. The wider debate, of course, is that just because you have a women leader does not mean that you have women empowerment there. As is the case in India, globally, there's a lot of gender gap to be bridged there. So that is about women leaders, and I think we have now just one more fact which I will cover now, which is so who's going to be the chief guest for India's Republic Day parade in 2018? Do you, if you know the answer, just nod in front of the screen. Okay, I'm now able to see all of you. I can see all 559 of you. Yeah, I can see all of you now. It's a joke, don't worry. So yeah, bad joke. So 2018, what Narendra Modi did when he visited the ASEAN summit, for the East Asia summit, was that he invited all the ASEAN leaders for the 2018 Republic Day to become the chief guests in the 2018 Republic Day, and it appears, it has been reported that they have all agreed that they will be jointly becoming the chief, coming as the chief guests for India's Republic Day parade in 2018. Now this I don't think will be asked, because hopefully by the time it was done, they would have said the paper. So for 2017, which is this year, the Crown Prince of Abu Dhabi was the chief guest. 2016 was Francois Hollande, the ex-president of France. The current president, of course, is the one who is positioning himself very well as a balancing force against Donald Trump. Emmanuel Macron is the new president of France, and a liberal one. He stands for an expanding European Union, free trade, acting against climate change, and all those liberal values. Right, so 2016 it was Francois Hollande, and again 2015 Barack Obama. I don't think we need to go. But anyway, Shinzo Abe is probably the, if you have to pick one leader who thinks very highly of India, it is the Prime Minister of Japan. And he and Modi have a very good partnership going on. I'm sure they must be calling each other every other day to discuss how to take on China. Yeah, so this concludes the session for today. 2013, I'll leave these points. Right, so this concludes the session for today. I have been probably quicker than I should be, just because these are facts and you need to go through these when you get the slides, or when you see the recording, preferably both. But I don't think justice has been done personally. I thought this one session should be enough, but I think we should do another session. And tentatively, let's keep it at 3 p.m. on this Saturday. I'm sure you're not writing an IIFT mock on this Saturday, and you will be taking the traditional advice of watching a movie before the exam. So you don't watch the movie, you attend the other session. I will probably be putting in more facts and facts, but do not judge me by these facts. Judge me by the analysis which I am capable of doing, which probably we will be doing a lot of during the interview season. I plan to do one session on your interview very soon, tentatively around the 10th of December. There also I must tell you, I am from, you know already, I think you have got 2-3 reminders. There's from, I'm from XLRI. I write CAT every year. And aside from the fact that I was the 100 percentile in verbal the last year, the point is that I am from Excel. I have written ZAT in every year, and I have, except for this year, since ZAT has gone online, I decided to retire officially from it. In 2015, I got 99.98 in ZAT, and I understand that decision making will be one section where you will be most worried about. So maybe I'll do one session on decision making, which is a very easy section, but is demonized, and I don't know, ridiculed, or all sorts of doubts are put in your minds, but a very easy section to deal with. Okay, a lot of things going forward. Please give your feedback. And if you liked the session, you did not like the session, you will surely like Knappily. So use the app. And the one point simply is, I must say this, this can be managed. You can get 3-4 right, 5-6 right, even if you, let's say, don't follow important news through the year. But in your interview, you know, the person who gets the maximum marks in an interview is the person who actually follows, loves and analyzes news and events. So do not wait for that and other things to be over. It hardly takes, I think, 10 minutes on Knappily to be regular with it. At least from today onwards, you'll be regular on it. And please give a 5-star rating if you like it. I have to say, so we want to maintain our rating. What else can I say? There's nothing. Please go ahead. It's 11, close to 11 now. It's for the first time that I've finished my session before time. I'm feeling bad about it. So there will be another session on Saturday, 3 p.m. And please attend. Nothing more to say. Thank you. Yeah, good night.